you've done a few of these now.
I have.
Have you had? Have you done your TV day, I guess?
Yes, I have.
So 3-minute clips with 1,700 people.
Yeah, exactly. It's an amazing experience. It's like really weird. But I guess since this is my first feature, like I don't mind this whole press junket thing as much as maybe other people do deep down.
Right.
And they're trying to hide their resentment of it. I'm not.
You're not resentful yet.
I'm not resentful yet. I'm genuinely enjoying it. I've been working on this movie for a year and a half. And so like it's a completely self-indulgent pleasure to get to talk about it again and again.
So you figured out the you have a shtick? Do you have
I do. I have shtick. I have like 6 or 7 stories that I like weave together interchangeably depending on the order of the questions.
Right.
Some people are better at asking specific things and getting, like, I'm not averse to I'll do a completely original interview if you're going to ask me a good question or two. But then, you know, but if you're not, then I'm gonna put something good on tape for you by giving you some pre-planned shtick.
So you're ready for pretty much anything.
You're
exactly. prepared. Did you get advice on this before you started?
I didn't. I think it's because I started out as an actor.
Right.
So I actually used to host a talk show when I was a little kid.
Huh.
I had a talk show in Baltimore. So
really?
Yeah, I did.
It was a televised talk show, a radio talk show?
Yeah, televised.
So how did that happen?
How
did a little kid end up with a talk show?
I was like really crazy type A when I was a kid, you know, like crazy ambitious.
Mm-hmm.
And like I like searched out in the newspaper like an audition or something and made my mom take me. It was the opposite of most, you know, like Hollywood mom things. Like my mom was like,
you were the stage son.
Yeah, I was the stage son. Yeah, exactly.
Mom, take me.
Yeah. It was like, if you want to go, I'll take you. So I went and it was like this show that was about interviewing local talented teens in the Baltimore, Washington area.
Huh.
But I was 10 years old at the time, and they hired me. So I was the kid. I was a 10-year-old kid interviewing like 12 to 15-year-olds about their talents.
So was that intimidating, or you just didn't care?
I guess I didn't care. I was digging it. I don't know. And then I ended up doing like a bunch of other like local TV things in Baltimore as a kid. And by age 15, I was unemployed.
So did you learn how to cut and how things came together by doing this? I mean, did you have a
sense
of...
A little bit. Yeah, I think so. I mean, smart of you to link that together with directing, in spite of the fact that I never really did myself.
Well,
but
I mean, if you have a sense of how television works, it's a different.
It's true. I did. I think I learned a lot as a kid about just like what works together and how things are perceived on camera and how, you know, a story gets told inside of a short period of time and you know, all that stuff. You know, at the same time, I was always doing the school plays and. I was also an artist. Like I drew and painted and took pictures.
So what school did you go to?
I went to Northwestern.
No, what school did you go to in Baltimore?
In Baltimore?
Yeah.
I went to Bedford Elementary, then Pikesville Middle, and then Friends School of Baltimore for high school.
Ironically, I'm from Pikesville. So
what?
Small world. I lived on Anton Farms Road when I was a child.
What? You lived in Anton Farms Road?
I did.
That's where my grandparents lived.
That's really funny.
I mean,
we were 3619.
I mean, I don't know their address actually.
We're part of the circle.
My family still lives on Stevenson Road.
Wow, we were just back there recently.
Wow.
So it's a Baltimore world, and also this January, at Sundance there was a film about a guy who came up in Baltimore and made himself into Elmo. Ultimately,
wow.
Who was not from Pikesville. He was from the other part of town. But
I feel disappointed in myself for not recognizing any sort of discernible accent in you.
Well, I don't have it for some reason. I avoided the Baltimore accent completely.
Well, maybe because you've been traveling,
I left when I was 7.
Ah, that's why.
Went to Miami.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
But I went to Hiscamuna and Bethel.
I mean, I drive past to go to my parents' house. You have to drive past Hiscamuna.
Yeah.
Like that's right. I mean, do you know where the Stevenson Road post office is?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's where my parents live, right next to it.
So Barry Levinson was a good role model for you.
Yes, exactly.
Same neighborhood,
Barry Levinson,
really.
John Waters.
Yeah.
I mean, Baltimore filmmakers. There's a great lineage.
Yeah. So what was the moment you thought, was it when you were unemployed at 15 that you were going to actually
direct?
Do something else?
No. Actually, I guess that experience led me to sort of accidentally think I wanted to be an actor, you know? And you know, I went to college and studied. I was like a performance studies major at Northwestern, mm-hmm. which is like the snobby version of a theater major. Yeah. It sort of combines literature and performance and. You know, I double majored in art because you got to have a safe backup. You know what I mean?
And were your parents completely like, this is all great, we're going for it? Or did they think you were crazy?
Totally. I mean, maybe that's just maybe you know, a liberal East Coast thing. I don't know. Or maybe it's a Jewish thing. I'm not sure. But regardless, it was the opposite. My brother thought he wanted to be a lawyer. Uh-huh. You know, and my dad used to say, my one son wants to be an actor and an artist. And I say, great. My other son wants to be a lawyer and I want to kill him.
So did he become a lawyer?
He did not, actually. He went into the family business. So,
there you go.
Yeah.
So you were at Northwestern.
Yeah.
And you were still acting was really your focus. I really wanted a group. So you left for New York? You went for L.A.?
I actually stayed in Chicago. I was in the comedy group at Northwestern, which is called the Meow Show. It's sort of the improv.
Where we got the lovely and talented
Julie
Louis-Dreyfus.
Yeah.
Brad Hall.
I just said Dreyf. I didn't, for some reason, finish the word Dreyfus.
So do you hang out with Gary Kroeger on weekends?
No. Okay. No, I don't. I don't. But you're right. You're identifying people that were in the Meow Show. It's incredible.
Which is what age? I hate to identify your age.
Yeah, sure. No, but, this was in... I graduated Northwestern in 1990. So this was...
So you're a little younger.
I was in the Meow Show
in
89, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they were all out in 84.
Wait a minute, I just completely made myself 4 years older than I am. That's not true at all. Okay. I graduated high school in 1990. I graduated in Northwestern in 1994. So I was in the Meow Show in 1993.
And those guys had already been through Saturday Night Live and gone by the time
Meow. Okay. Exactly. So I was a next generation Meow Show performer.
So you did that and then you went professional in Chicago?
Well, as much as you could go professional in improv,
a good living doing improv in Chicago.
You can, actually. That's true. Yeah. Whether if you're in a touring company in Second City, mm-hmm. and I did a little bit of that, but I mainly studied at Improv Olympic with Del mm-hmm. Close, who's sort of like the guru of improvisation. He's passed on now, but he was an incredible teacher, and you know, he wrote this book called Truth in Comedy, which mm-hmm. you know, his emphasis was all about, he didn't care if it was haha funny right away. Right. He believed that you would get to something that was more rewardingly funny for the audience mm-hmm. if you made it real, you know. So mm-hmm. that was my training, you know, with Del, who, you know, Del is a guy who was credited as the metaphysical consultant on the first two seasons of Saturday Night Live, which basically meant that he provided the drugs.
There were a lot of people providing drugs.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, yeah. But he taught Belushi, Radner, Murray, yeah. Farley, and was really an incredible influence. And then I moved to L.A. Yeah.
And did you come to L.A. going, okay, I'm just... L.A. find me, or was it easy trip for you?
No, when I first landed in L.A., my first job, I was a room service waiter at the Chateau Marmont.
Wow.
Actually, was what I first did.
So and that puts you very close to what, it's like putting your nose up against the glass, isn't
yeah,
it?
A little bit? In a weird way, that's what it was. Yeah. I was watching all these celebrities in a fish tank, you mm-hmm. know, delivering their lattes and their extra strong margaritas.
So that inspire you or irritate you, or?
It was part of the adventure at that time, mm-hmm. to be honest. It gave me a lot of stories to tell, and some of which I would be embarrassed to repeat or wouldn't want to mm-hmm. Give away anyone's secrets. Part of the code of being a room service waiter.
There you go. You're still holding true to that.
Exactly. I'm still true to that. still friends with the general manager of the hotel. Wow. Can't betray him.
Of course. And have you seen Somewhere yet?
What?
Have you seen the Sofia Coppola movie yet?
I have. Okay. I have. And it was particularly amazing to watch it because it was weird for me because I had been in all those rooms. Yeah. Totally.
But not with the stripper poles, or have they been, or you can't say?
I think that stripper pole was added for that scene, but not the mirrors.
Okay.
So there's a, yeah. Anyway.
It's good to know.
Yeah, exactly.
So what got you to the next step from...
Well, you know, I sort of accidentally fell into supporting myself as an actor in Los Angeles, which is mm-hmm. the dream for a lot of people. But because in college, I came from doing comedy, and even when I did plays in school, mm-hmm. you know, I would do the photography and design the poster. right. for the publicity and help build the set and direct the fight sequence mm-hmm. in addition to being an actor in the production. Mm-hmm. So it was an all-encompassing creative experience. And when I started doing it professionally, I felt like a much smaller cog in mm-hmm. somebody else's machine, and I didn't like that feeling. Mm-hmm. Maybe it's because I have a bit of a Napoleon complex, or maybe it's because, it was just creatively, unfulfilling. Mm-hmm. Or I didn't like being in the car so much as I drove from audition to audition. whatever it was, I knew that I needed to not be that annoying actor that was sitting on set thinking I could do this better. Mm-hmm. Because I was that guy for a little while thinking right. You hired me to say that one line, but now I'm sitting here thinking, why are you putting the camera there? Why are you doing it in this order? This is mm-hmm. so inefficient. I had to basically put my money where my mouth was. Mm-hmm. So I took all the money I made as an actor and made a short film with it, which was sort of stupid as a business move, but mm-hmm. ended up panning out.
And you just got an agent from that and all that?
Yeah,
as a director?
Yeah, that was sort of like the dream story.
Was your agency interested in you as a director at all?
No, not at all.
Your acting agency was
exactly. Out. When that happened, I had to fire all the people that were basically ignoring me as an actor, and I mm-hmm. got agents that represented me as a writer and director. Because mm-hmm. the second I made this short, it right. was called The Adventures of Big Handsome Guy and His Little Friend. I wrote it with a buddy of mine from Chicago, mm-hmm. and it was about these two guys, sort of a night in the life story. Mm-hmm. It's sort of like Swingers meets Batman and Robin. This tall, handsome guy, everything in life is easy for him. Mm-hmm. He doesn't understand neuroses or worry because he's never had to experience them. Mm-hmm. And a short guy, played by me at the time, because I couldn't find anybody who would do it better for free. Yeah, yeah, exactly. and their sort of unlikely friendship and the way that while they were best friends, they also didn't understand each other at all.
I feel a theme in your work now.
Yeah, there kind of is.
The whole Batman thing.
It's in Arthur. Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. I mean, a way to bring it full circle.
It all came to you. So you were in your single digits when Arthur was first released.
I was.
So did it have any resonance for you? Were part of the HBO generation watching things over and over again?
Well, that's exactly it. Arthur was in a heavy rotation on HBO when I was coming home from school unsupervised. And watching it was sort of like this naughty pleasure, this glimpse into a world that I felt like I wasn't quite supposed to be old enough to see, and mm-hmm. I loved it. It was one of my first favorite movies.
Either that or Eddie and the Cruisers.
Eddie and the Cruisers.
At the time.
Yes, you couldn't be more correct.
Unfortunately, I was watching them too.
Yeah.
So, though I was old enough to have watched Arthur in the theaters back in Chicago, ironically, back in the day. So you had a reference for this.
I did. And the notion of remaking it seemed crazy to me.
So how did that first show up in your
portfolio? I after that short film I told you about, right. We sold that short film as a pilot, mm-hmm. and then the pilot didn't go, but they wanted me to direct something else for the studio. This was 20th Century Fox. And then I made a series of pilots for them mm-hmm. that got really close in various ways to going to air. And then finally I did Modern Family, directed the pilot of Modern Family, and that took off. And mm-hmm. I was in the midst of season one of Modern Family, and suddenly mm-hmm. all sorts of feature scripts were coming across my desk. And I really didn't have time to pay attention to a lot of them, but one of them was a remake of Arthur. And my first reaction was, I was almost incensed. I was like, why would you do that? Why would you want to make a remake of this movie? Because it's great, mm-hmm. But then they told me that Russell Brand was attached to play Arthur, and I thought, well, if there's one guy who's going to reinvent this part for a generation of people mm-hmm. that maybe haven't even heard of the original movie, it's him. Because I was a big Russell Brand fan, mm-hmm. both from Sarah Marshall and from being familiar with his stand-up and even his book, which I just found incredibly fascinating and articulate.
So you shot Modern Family one camera, or is it multiple camera?
Well, it's a one camera style, meaning it's shot like a movie, but we shoot with two cameras simultaneously all the time, so it's to give it that documentary feel.
So any sense of there being a difference for you in terms of going from one hat to the other?
Yeah, I mean, there's a definite difference in the size of the toys.
Yes.
You know what I mean? In the feature world.
And certainly the speed with which you have to deliver.
That's true. although, I guess doing television and Modern Family couldn't have been better training, not just because Steve Levitan and Chris Lloyd, who are the executive producers of that show, are sort of brilliant in terms of diagnosing the comedic scenes, understanding what's funny about them, and if something's not working, knowing how to fix it. I've never seen any guys that approach that so scientifically and that understand that so thoroughly, and I learned so much from them that I was able to carry over into Arthur.
Right.
But also the speed with which we had to move. I mean, you know, in spite of the fact that it's a, you know, big Hollywood movie, you still have to do an impossible amount in an impossibly short period of time because the scale is so much bigger and what you're trying to accomplish is so much bigger. So if I hadn't had that the sprint of television, I never would have been trained for the marathon that was the movie shoot.
So was there any sense of intimidation in terms of just making the movie? Forget about that it's Arthur, but that you're, you know, going to make a big feature film that's going to get, you know, they're going to spend however many tens of millions of dollars making and, you know, $50 million marketing.
Totally. I mean, it is intimidating when you think about it in that terms, which is why I try not to.
that makes sense.
But I think the most intimidating thing in the whole process is the prospect of working with Helen Mirren, who is a dame. She played the queen.
Yes.
And she's like one of the most renowned dramatic actresses of her generation. And so for me, it was, I felt so honored. And I had to get over that really quickly. You know what I mean? The first time I met her, I was invited to her house for tea. And my agent was like freaking out because he was like, "You're having tea with a British person. There's rules. Do you know the etiquette of having it?" And he sent me a link to a website that told me things like, "You're supposed to stir the tea in a back and forth motion and not in a circle because that could chip the china." You know what I mean?
Good to know.
Yeah, exactly. And of course, none of this came in handy when I actually met Helen and when I arrived at her house and she made the tea in mismatching mugs with Lipton tea bags and water heated up from the microwave. So
was she attached when you came on board?
She was not. Russell was.
So Russell was in.
Russell was in, and Helen was my first choice and his to play Hobson, and it was a matter of convincing her.
Was there a second choice? I mean, it's almost hard to imagine who a second choice would be.
I know.
It was the fact that she was female. Coincidental to her, or would you have maybe gone in a male route again if she didn't do it?
I don't think so. I think Peter Bainham, the screenwriter, sort of conceived this idea that Hobson would be his nanny instead of his butler. And for me, that was the core comedic idea that made this unique and different from the original, you know? Not just because it's funny to think about Russell Brand as a 35-year-old man having a nanny, but also because it creates a different emotional relationship. You know, she becomes a kind of surrogate mother figure, and there's a real sweetness to that relationship that was present even in the script before you add Russell and Helen to the mix, who as people have this tremendous and genuine affection for each other that I hope comes across on screen.
So then you go to Angela Lansbury and then Brian Cox and drag. Is that the
I mean, look, I'm not gonna
it's a
lie,
short list.
there was a list, but I'm not sure we would have actually made the movie if Helen hadn't said yes.
And where did the other choices come? I mean, Jennifer obviously brings a cachet with her. Was that easy? Did you audition her, or
no,
was it just an idea somebody had?
I mean, we were talking about it. I think it was in a meeting where we brought up Jennifer Garner, and we were like, "Wow, that would be amazing." Mm-hmm. We knew this character. We wanted this character to be strong and to have the ability to dominate Russell. Mm-hmm. And we were like, "What actress could do that?" And we thought, "Well, oh, Jennifer, but yeah, she would never do this, would she?" Would you maybe? And it turned out that at the time, this is a little insider information for you, at the time, Jennifer was doing a movie that she was producing, an independent movie called Butter, which co-starred Ty Burrell from Modern Family. She had cast Ty as her husband in the movie and was a big fan of Modern Family. And Ty was able to whisper in her ear, like, "You should do this. You should work with Jason. Like, it's really fun and blah, blah, blah." And that opened the door, at least wide enough for me to get on the phone with her, talk to her about the role, and talk to her about how much fun I thought we could have transforming her into a villain with complex motivations. And She was game, you know, thank goodness, because I think she's delightful in the movie, and it's fun seeing her in, you know, a leopard print raincoat and a bustier.
Which pretty much, I think everybody in Modern Family has worn at some
point. Yeah, everybody, yeah.
That's, I think every that's character at some
standard
point.
Standard practice for Modern Family. Actually, I think Julie Bowen did wear, she did wear a raincoat with nothing underneath for one episode.
I remember
Valentine's
that.
Day.
Happy Valentine's Day.
Yeah, right.
And didn't the kids walk in on her at that point? Or was another
that was a different, okay. a different sexually tinged episode.
Oh, the sexual tinges of Modern Family.
Yes, exactly.
So, and Greta is kind of like an introducing character here, because she really, unlike Liza Minnelli, probably little known to the people who are the core audience for this, who are, you know, not the indie geeks.
Yeah, it's true.
Where did you get that idea? And where?
Well, Greta really blew me away with her performance in Greenberg opposite Ben Stiller. I mean, she was incredible in that movie. And that's where I sort of first started. That's where I got introduced to her, you know. And then I started to research her and realize that not only did she star in these Sundance movies that are known as the mumblecore films, you know, The Puffy Chair and A Hand Takes the Stairs, and she also produced and co-wrote in some cases, and there was something I loved about the do-it-yourself spirit that she had. But that was all just why I got curious about her for the role. The reason she got the role was because of the audition she had with Russell, where she... You know, we read a lot of actresses opposite Russell, and he is so quick, so lightning fast with his wit that it could actually be off-putting or startling if you're not game to play along. And she said a thing or two in her audition that actually knocked him back on his heels, made him break, laugh out loud. She was the only actress that where that happened. And on top of that, she has this sweetness to her, this almost... lovable awkwardness that, in my opinion, softened Russell, and in the experience of watching the movie, makes you fall in love with him for loving her.
Right. So was she a hard thing to convince Warner Brothers to do?
A little bit. You know, I mean, Warner Brothers, to their credit, was really receptive to, you know, a lot of the choices and creatively supportive throughout the process.
So you're already kind of loaded with the three of them.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we had Russell and Helen and Jennifer. So they were open to the idea of going with a fresh face, because I personally, as a director, I wanted the character of Naomi, the love interest, to be very different than Liza Minnelli's love interest in the movie, because there's only one Liza.
Right.
And if there was anything that we were trying to imitate about that character, it would have, you know, come across as false. So it's no accident that she's the one character in the movie that has a different name than the original, because she's a completely different kind of character with a different backstory and, you know, different dreams.
But she does have a yellow raincoat.
She does have a yellow raincoat, just briefly.
Yes.
And then she sheds it in the course of the scene where you meet her.
So are you, I mean, the homages to the original in this film, are they improv, some of them? Or are they things you just kind of plotted in there and just stuck little... beats?
There are little Easter eggs. There's a couple of references that if you know the original well, you know that they're a tip of the cap.
Well, just so a good Gilgud imitation now and again.
Yeah,
there are three or four of them.
Yeah, exactly. but you know, the script started out with a lot of homage lines in it. Peter Bainham had written very creatively, used some quotes from the original in new contexts, in different contexts in the new script. And as we developed the script and as we went through the process of making the movie, they kind of each fell out one by one. And I was sort of proud of that, because I felt like it meant we were finding our own legs. It meant like everybody was finding what was funny about their characters and connecting to each other as actors, and like kind of developing our own comedy bits. Like, I felt like the best thing we could do to pay homage to the original was capture its tone and its spirit without ever imitating it directly. You know what I mean? And so that's what we tried to do throughout.
So was the challenge of doing it for an hour and a half, or an hour and 40 minutes, or whatever it was, as opposed to 24? I mean, ultimately, you have to put the whole thing together, and it's a cohesive long thing, and not a sprint.
Yeah, exactly.
Is that a different thing? Was that difficult for you, or?
Well, it's difficult for me because I'm an impatient person. Uh-huh. And I loved, I mean, it was so gratifying to direct an episode of Modern Family and have it be on the air like 4 weeks later.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like to be able to tell somebody, oh, we're doing this story about this thing, and then they see it. You know what I mean? And so the only thing that was hard about this process was waiting so long to share it with people. You know what I mean? Like working on it meticulously for so long and waiting for it to be seen, but... Now we're kind of at that finish line.
Well, cutting must have been a little different for you, though. I mean, in television, generally, the cutting kind of comes together. Somebody's in a room somewhere, a dark room, and the pieces are all there.
Yeah.
It's really very defined what the pieces are going to be. There's not a lot of
There's not
coloring
as
outside of the lines.
Experimentation, because there's not as much time for it.
Right.
But yeah, with a movie, there's the movie you shot, and then there's the movie you discover you have in the editing room, and you got to sort of be willing to go with that and change with it.
So great enjoyment for you in that?
Or? Yeah, there is. There's a great enjoyment in discovering what the real movie is in the editing room.
And did you get to do a lot of improv along the way?
Lots of it. Yeah. Russell's one of the best improv comedians out there. Mm-hmm. And it would be foolish of me as a director not to embrace that and encourage that. And my job was just to focus it, to say, like, after he would go on an incredible flight of fancy, to say, like, the third thing in there, that's the one that I would use because that fits with the character and that enhances the story this way. So on the next take, let's take that idea and expand on it. You know what I mean? So he and I had a great rapport in that regard.
And will opening day be scary for you? Or are you going to sit there and go to a theater or two?
I don't know. I don't know how opening day could not be scary for me. It's my first feature. I want people to see it, and I hope they like it. So it's definitely nerve-wracking.
I assume you've seen it with test screening audiences.
I have. And they've responded really well. So hopefully the real audience will respond the same way.
So is that wave of laughter anything like the experience of being an actor and getting the wave of laughter? Or is it another world for you?
You know, it's not unlike it. It is gratifying in the same way. The good news is that because you're not delivering the line live, you know it's going to come out right. So that's reassuring.
So and how quickly do you know you have them or don't have them in something like Arthur? Is there a joke that you are waiting for in the first few minutes?
Yeah, there's a couple of those. There's a couple of those in the first few minutes where I feel like if the audience laughs at that, we're going to have them for the
rest of the
ride.
So what's the first joke?
I can't give it away. I'm not giving it away.
Well, people are going to see this after they've seen the movie.
No, I'm not going to speculate because different people might think different things are funny. I'm not going to.
And if they watch this in Yugoslavia, they'll get into that joke.
Exactly.